Hi, everyone. I'm Syed. I work for Eureqa.
Today, we're going to talk about a few operational challenges that are unmanageable when we use large-scale grid and node combination. And we also, we did a lot of executions on node and grid combination, and over the years, we came across many problems, and we keep on finding solutions, and we are improving ourselves. Today, we're going to talk about few of our challenges, major challenges with logging and operational challenges with node and grid setup. Let me ask a few questions. How many of you know Selenium grid? Okay, that's cool.
Okay, it's 2/3. So how many of you use Selenium grid in order to run your tests?
Wow. Half of it. How many of you extensively use Selenium grid? That's cool.
So you totally rely on Selenium grid.
Okay.
Yes, okay.
How many test runs happening per day in your runs? What is the max count? 100?
Approximately.
300? 1,000? Over the grid?
Yeah.
Nice.
Nice.
Okay, for few doesn't know about Selenium grid, we'll just touch up on what is Selenium grid.
As most of you have already said that you are using Selenium grid, I just want to have an overview on that. It's a load balancer, actually, which concurrently distributes the test across various platforms. And the main disadvantage having the Selenium grid is you mainly reduce your time in order to test your test suites or test cases. This is a major advantage, and even the Selenium grid fastens your tests by, doing the load balancing, having, as he said, thousands runs happening a day. The all balancing done at the Selenium grid side.
Over the few years, we are executing thousands of runs every day to suffice all our customers and LOBs and developers' needs. And we do execute parallel runs and cross-browser testing. We do a lot of activity over the years. And operationally, we are seeing there are many practical challenges while debugging. There are developers who actually schedule runs and LOBs schedule runs over the night through CI tools. And the practical issue is the debugging. What if the run fails? And every developer wants to see their logs. Operationally, the nodes are sitting idly in the controls of operations team. And distributing logs distributing is highly challenging. The very first challenge we are encountering is the clients, the developers, the users who are actually executing a test run, they never know on which node their run went to, and on which node the run being executed. Maybe while running, you can see on the grid console, but after execution, there is no way to track that. The only tracking point is capturing Selenium session ID into the developer logs and passing the session ID to the operations team to get the respective logs. That is only way. If you don't want, or developers don't want to capture Selenium session ID in their logging, the other alternative is creating a unique run ID or test ID from each developer and sharing that ID with the operations team. And also we need to make a little code change in the Selenium code to capture the run ID and print it in the logs so that they can grab it, they can search for it and share with the developers. That's another alternative. That will be more challenging if at all you have to support thousands of developers, thousands of test cases. We may get 100 requests a day. And even that will be more difficult and practically very difficult to handle if you have log rotation policy, because it generates a huge logging. If at all you have a log rotation policy and log purging and archival policy, if a developer comes back after a week and asking for their run status,
or run log, it is very difficult to search for it and parse for it. It's very time consuming and resource, everything. It's a practical challenge which we have faced. If they can print the run ID in the logs, that is the only way to get it. But again, that's challenging.
And in order to have this test ID, the unique ID, you need to do a little code change. As we know, we have different capabilities, right? Before we launch any test, we set the capabilities, right? In the same way, we need to have a capability by name test ID, where you need to set the unique test ID for every execution, right? Then anyhow, we are displaying the log, right? In the log, you can uniquely identify the test ID. Oh, wait, you can see the highlighted one. And the second challenge, what we were facing is multiple sessions, the same log.
Yes.
Is it what you are logging as your automation script, or is what Selenium node claim server is logging?
Yeah, this is our own logging system actually.
Server logging.
We have created the code. This is not our actual Selenium log.
This is not what the grid is logging.
Yes, this is a node.
Node logs.
What are the log files you are seeing?
But the node logs automatically comes back to where your server is running from, right? So it doesn't.
It all depends how you started your node, right? If at all you starting a node, and if you redirect the logging into the different file, the file will be residing in a shared folder somewhere. You will get a log with stack trace to your program, right?
Actually, there are different kinds of logging. Even you can have a driver specific logging, right? Let's say probe or header, right? So this is a
node
normal
log.
Usual node log. Okay. And the second challenge, multiple sessions, same log. Let's say the client is executing multiple test runs, the test, and that all executions will go into the same log file. You can see in the highlighted one, where your client is trying to execute two test runs, where you can see the overlap log. You cannot differentiate what is the specific request for this execution. You cannot differentiate. It's more of a time-taking process in order to debug that log, right? For this, we have an ideal two solutions. The first one would be, if you can afford, you can dedicate a fresh VM for every execution. You can run only node with a single capability on it. And once the test execution completes, have a process to rename the log file and with a unique session ID, anyhow it generates a session ID, unique session ID, have the same session ID as the file name, and save it to your location. And move the log file into a folder that is accessible by the developers. The reason being, moving this log file to the accessible to developers is, in order to, let's say tomorrow I have a issue with a certain test suite, I want to debug it. Using the test ID, I'll take all the log file, and anyhow it's getting saved using the session ID, right? I'll check for the specific timestamp and specific command. Then next, even let's say if you cannot afford having a fresh VM allocation for each execution, you can have a new VM for each test execution and want to host multiple test executions. We can even have a single session running on a node, restricting that node should have a only single session. In this, the only difference between these two solutions is, in the first solution, you are having your log file with the session ID, the unique session ID. In the second, you are having with the test ID. It all depends on how you log your execution log file. And the same thing, the store the log file in a folder that is accessible by the developers. In order to track the issues, we have a common folder system where the developer can access the log files. And this is the third challenge. Selenium executor logs by default only print time but not date. Agree? Yeah, you can see at the left hand side. You can see only the timestamp. And you can see the request response coming to and from the Selenium node. Right? So for this, what we have, we enhanced the logging system. We included the date and time. You can see over here, the date, the timestamp, anyhow, the Selenium has provided, and you can see the request response saying the Selenium node request executing, and you're seeing the response coming back from the node. And this is very, it's the main advantage of having this enhanced logging is it's more readability in order to track the issues, to trace the issues.
Again, as a operations lead, we usually get every day a request from developers or the LOBs that they are observing, basically they test completed, but the test completed, but there is no screenshots. But tests are taking too long than usual. And sometimes tests are abruptly closed. That's called aborted suddenly. They didn't get any stack trace. And sometimes they have some other issue. It's performing low. It's moving very, very low than usual. If it is escalated to operations team has high challenges to understand what actually or exactly happened or happening during the execution of the particular test run. Until unless they have a strong metrics, a system level metrics or node level metrics, it is very difficult for them to debug it. They need to know what is a system memory, a system CPU, and other JVM memory, or how IE driver is performing, how Chrome driver is performing, how many IEs are launched, even though you execute, even though you control one session, there might be a session which already went in, abruptly closed, and left the session or left the IE driver open in the process, in the task manager. So until unless these guys, operations team, have this information, it will be very difficult for them to debug and come back. So we have to have a mechanism to capture real time and frequent polls. What is the system CPU, system memory, and JVM memory, how much JVM is taking, how much IE drivers and browsers are taking the memory and system and CPU percentages. Similarly, from the node end, we can capture a command and target values and a response and request and capture time and what is a node name, what is a node OS, and what is the other attributes of system and XMLs, and persist everything in the database. Now everything we have in the database. So even though we don't have logs tomorrow, and apps team can correlate the data between what exactly happened versus during your execution. And they can see a graphs or pictorial representation of the data into reports.
I just want to add to Raghu. Generally, you'll see in specific to IE driver, even though you use driver.quit, sometimes you see the Windows pop-up coming up saying that, do you really want to close this program? Have you ever, faced this issue? Right?
In that situations, it leaves the thread open in the task manager. If you schedule another IE session, the session will invoke. The session ID will be created, but nothing will progress there.
Yes.
It's not only model dialog, it's crash message, IE crashed.
You can see the message, the executable has crashed. You can see the message, and at the bottom you'll see the close the program option, right? If I'm not wrong.
If you run heavy.
That's the difference from the one that you were talking about. Do you really want to close the browser? Is the model kind of thrown by the
browser? Close the program. I didn't say browser, I said it's a close the program. The process. The IE driver process.
Okay. And similarly, there are n number of other parameters influence your test cases, right? While executing, like if Java memory is already reached its peak and it is not responsive, that has to be tracked. If Chrome is already hung, and if you schedule another IE, that may influence other runs. So if at all you have all this information through some metrics collected and persisted in the database, and now we have we can run analytics to see what exactly happened during that time. And we can give this data to the developers for their own debugging. And operations team can little relax for some time. Open the data. If at all I have a run something like this, and I scheduled it like searching for a book or CD in Amazon, and executed run is happened. It happened 1 week back. Now a developer came back from his vacation asking operations team, what happened to my run? But it took longer time. or I didn't get the screenshot, or it failed, then they can immediately open the report and see what is the command actually executed and what is the duration of the command executed, when it was executed, and if they click on that, any of the command, it will give you other system metrics like how much CPU and memory and other driver information or JVM information during that time. It will be very helpful if you do extensive executions, this information very helpful to know the difference between AUT failure versus system failures. There are many situations, maybe AUT issue, AUT is crashed, AUT is thrown a 500 error, but system, these are the issues to easy to debug if you know the issue with AUT or the system. And these are the places where
these are the list of files where I said that we have enhanced the logging system, right? These are the list of files. And the last file is for the include the date format. We have our own specific date format, which appends to the timestamp.
Just further analysis, like if at all we know which browser is available. If at all I'm scheduling one run, if we can throw a message to the user saying that, OK, there are IE8s 10 sitting, why don't you pick Chrome? If you can pass on, like if at all you pick something like which is unavailable now, it may take 36 minutes for you to pick if you schedule this run. Why don't you pick another available browser? This will be calculated if at all you know the control on the execution side, how many nodes, how many browsers, or how many capabilities are free at this point. Yeah. Yes, please. That's good, but if at all you want to build a generic framework, any developer, you don't need to bother about the execution engine, like how the commands are transformed. If at all you want to build a keyword driven where Excel.
Let me rephrase my question.
Okay.
My question is with respect to what gets logged on your log, right?
Yes. Yes.
Right. So I'm guessing that the guy who actually plays a role in displaying whatever is available on that system is basically a formatter.
That's correct.
Right. So which means Selenium, you would basically be able to bundle in more than one jar on your class bar, and then spin off a load using a Java CP instead of using a Java jar. Right. So all you had to do was create your own formatter, which basically extends a default formatter.
Yes, yes, we agree. That would be another option, but we have tried with this option.
That's true. That's correct. If at all your ops team allows to do that.
This has nothing to do with the ops team allowing me because, I will be interacting with the grid using the IP and a board, right? So I'm going to be using the same provided infrastructure to query the log files, the log content, just as I would be able to use the same session ID and then ask the grid, no, Mr. Grid, here's my session ID, you tell me what is the IP and what is the port and the node to which this test was.
That's correct. But is that only runtime or is that post also?
No, this is only runtime.
Runtime, right? My concern is, my operations concern is post execution. After 1 week, we log such a purge, logs rotated. What if? What we need to do?
Yeah, but the thing is,
that's my main concern. That's the main frustration from my operations point of view. Developers schedule their runs through CI, and every day it runs. They comes back after a week and ask for where is my log. They query, they do whatever they want to do, but there is no log because log is already purged. Because it generates huge log, because thousands and thousands of runs a day, it goes to GBs. We have to purge it every day. That's where we came with this another solution to get only required information from the entire log of GB. Maybe you need at least 120 lines. We'll take the information as command, value, request, response, and persist in the database. Database maybe have 4 lines. That will give us, right? That's all you need as a developer to see where it exactly failed. You don't need to look for all the 10,000 lines of code. This is more practical. In my case, developers won't sit before systems and execute runs and debug it. Everyone, right? So this all gives you a permanent solution for the post debugging.
Okay, so the third question I was basically having was, so you guys collect a lot of information with respect to the JVM and the memory being used and all of that stuff, right? So earlier today there was another session which was basically talking about self-healing capabilities of the grid. I mean, within my company, we have also...
Can you a little bit louder?
So today, earlier today, there was another session which was basically on something called as Selenium Grid Extras, right, which basically talks about building some sort of auto-healing abilities within the grid. So, I come from PayPal, so I have also worked on building some self-healing capabilities within the grid and all of that stuff. So just trying to understand, if a person is basically going through a mechanism wherein after n number of runs, they basically recycle a node or recycle a VM itself, do you think all of these monitoring systems that you are basically...
This is the second point, right, I was talking?
Right.
That's what where we want to go.
You were showing me some statistics with respect to the JVM usage and all of that, right? So if eventually you probably get to this point, do you think all of those information would still be required?
Still be required, yes. If at all you do session recycling maybe after 100 sessions, right? Maybe if you run a heavy browser load application, 100 sessions within this 1 minute, that's enough to crash IE browser. And that enough to reach a JVM peak. Mm-hmm. It depends upon how frequently, how much load you're going to put on the node. It's not irrespective of how frequently you recycle it. Mm-hmm. It's all is matters like how much load at the end a node or JVM is carrying.
Okay.
That matters. Okay. And this again, it's a debugging purpose.
Right.
Is that really JVM matters? Basically, it gives the developers to think in 2 directions. Should I bother about my AUT changes? Should I bother about my script changes? Should I bother about environmental issue? If it is environmental issue, let me out from the system. It's their issue.
Okay.
That gives them.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions? Okay. Should we wrap up? Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.